City. Okay, so we have before us the agenda. Has the agenda been posted?
It has, and certified by the clerk. It was an adjustment to agenda item 6 that was sent after the agenda went out. When we get to that item, it was a small change. Other than that, Mr. Chair, we're good to go.
Okay, the agenda is before the board.
Second.
This motion is second. Any discussion? Any objection? Without objection, the agenda is approved by unanimous vote. Item 10, the January 9th, 2018 Montecito debris flow presentation.
Mr. Chair, thank you. If our legal counsel steps in and if you ask a question, and as you know, there's a fair bit of litigation around both fires and debris flows, so we're trying to be just very careful in how we frame and in the questions we ask. So if our legal counsel has you rephrase something, we just wanted to let you know that might happen. I want to introduce Maureen Spencer. She's with Santa Barbara County Flood Control, and I want to thank Maureen for being here and her expertise.
Good morning. I wanted to start out with a little explanation about the permitting for an emergency event. And as you all know, we woke up on 1/9 with a pretty amazing event going on. And got to work and immediately notified the regulatory agencies that we have to get emergency permits from. We notified the Army Corps, the Regional Board, Fish and Wildlife, and the Coastal Commission via email and some phone calls, but most everything was via email. And we received responses from all of those agencies that very same day. And we continued to talk to all of those agencies throughout the emergency response. And as you know, you've all heard, it's cliche, it was unprecedented. It was amazing. It included very difficult situations, very difficult logistics, and unfortunately included the task of going through debris while recovering victims. For many people that work for the county. When we started our emergency response, it was January. It was at the very beginning of when we received most of our heavy rains in that season. And so we were responding to that emergency, but we were also getting ready for the next events that could be coming. So it was a very, very serious situation. As you know, hundreds of homes were destroyed or damaged. Riparian corridors were literally stripped of vegetation for thousands of feet. And in having that happen, biological resources were eliminated. And a lot of these drainages, mud and boulders, trees, went across the landscape and through houses. And the debris flow was hundreds of feet wide and up to 30 feet deep in places. Bridges were destroyed. Some creeks literally were eroded to bedrock. Other creeks were filled beyond capacity. We had bridges that were completely blocked. Huge boulders came down. We were talking about the boulders the size of cars came down. They were all over the place. And debris plugs that were 15 feet tall and 100 feet long were blocking drainages. It was a big event. It was nothing that any of us had ever have dealt with. And a lot of us have been around through the 1995 and the 1998 and all those really large events. For the county, over 500,000 cubic yards of material was removed from debris basins, creeks, and roads. So that's just what we processed. And when I say we, it's the county, but also the Army Corps of Engineers who stepped in and did all of the desilting of our debris basins. So really, as our emergency response started, the very first thing that we were involved with was rescue and recovery and literally clearing some roads so that we can assist the first responders to get into these places, because many of the places we couldn't even get into. And then we from that point on, we proceeded forward. And some of the very first things that were done was removing those debris plugs from the bridges so that we can get the creeks back into their drainages. And then doing minimal drainage and, and, and then just all-out effort. I have a selection of photos that I'm going to go through to give you some examples of some of the emergency response that we did. So you can go ahead and move forward. We talked to the regulatory agencies the entire time that we were doing emergency response, and we also produce a post-emergency report that's been given to the regulatory agencies. And this is one of the figures that was sent to the regulatory agencies. And so while we were responding, we had what we referred to as a working map. So every time we would identify a new place that we had to go in and do work, we would put it on a map, and then we had different shading and colors of where there was in progress and who was doing the work and those kinds of things. But this is the end product. And so you can see where, you know, we were all over the place. And a lot of people talk about Montecito. Well, there was a lot of work that occurred in Carpinteria as well, and you can see that on that map. It's a little hard to see, but it shows areas that the Army Corps of Engineers did extra creek work and such, and I'll go over that. Go ahead through. So this is just a summary of some of the material. These are all approximate. 400,000 cubic yards were taken from debris basins. 70,000 cubic yards was hauled from the creeks by the Army Corps of Engineers. 26,000 cubic yards of material was dredged from Carpinteria salt marsh. And then 22,000 cubic yards was dragline desilted from Carpinteria salt marsh. So what we did is that the first clearing in Carpinteria salt marsh was with cranes and trucks. And those are in areas of Franklin and Santa Monica Creek that we can reach with cranes and haul with trucks. And then the lower portion of Franklin Creek, we did a hydraulically dredge project there. We discharged to the east of Carpinteria salt marsh mouth. And then 40,000 cubic yards was deposited at Goleta Beach. We refer to that as emergency disposal. We don't refer to it as nourishment. That is the term that we're using for that. And then 28,000 cubic yards was deposited at Carpinteria Beach at the end of Ash Avenue. And most of the material that was at Ash Avenue, of that 22,000 cubic yards of that, was from Carpinteria salt marsh. Now, so this is Buena Vista Creek. I just want to give people an idea of what it looked like out there if you didn't have a chance. This is Buena Vista Creek, and then the lower portion, that's East Valley Road. It just literally was full of mud, and then Buena Vista Creek is filled to capacity. Okay. I want to give you an idea of a before and after photo. This is a Cold Springs debris basin looking downstream way before the floods, and then the next one is the after the flood. That's what it looked like on January 9th. Yeah. That's a little different. Yeah. The landscape is very different. The drainages are very different. Okay. This is Cold Springs debris basin full of material. Some of those rocks are literally the size of cars. Many, many of those rocks are huge. And again, the Army Corps of Engineers through FEMA and Cal OES desilted all of our basins. Okay. This is Cold Springs empty. Getting ready for the next storm. I think this is probably in March when we had our next storm. Some before and after of Arroyo Peridon Creek. This is more Army Corps of Engineers work. In many situations, we were able to get in with contractors and some of our own crews and just do very, very minimal clearing, just to clear it enough to get a little bit of flow and get material away from bridges. And then we contracted through FEMA and Cal OES to put those creeks back to their pre-storm condition in terms of width. This is Toro Canyon Creek, more Army Corps of Engineers work. Okay. Hot Springs Creek, it was all over the place. You know, you can see on that upper left the amount of material that's in the creeks. It just, you know, we talk about how much came out, but there's a lot that was just still in the creeks themselves, and there's a lot of material still on the creeks that's going to come down with subsequent rain. Okay. This is Romero Creek. on the upper left. This is right after we did some very, very minimal clearing to try and get that water to go under and under Sheffield.
Those homes there?
Those are homes on the left. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Right, okay. This is a bridge on Gubernador Canyon Creek that had was completely blocked with vegetation, trees, and such. And, you know, these, that's just one. That's just one picture. You know, that's, there's, there were many, many other situations that, with that. Okay. This is Santa Monica Debris Basin. This is a huge debris basin. It's our largest debris basin. It's over 100,000 cubic yard capacity. I don't, if some of you may have been out there and seen it, there are three very, very tall towers, concrete towers underneath all of that material, and that next picture will show them. So there they are there.
Oh.
Yeah. Okay. This is Villa Real at Arroyo Peridon Creek. And so, you know, it happened in CARP as well. And there was that picture that USGS showed of the mouth. Arroyo Peridon had huge amounts of debris in it. Okay.
The Arroyo Peridon?
Yes. Thing? Yes, it is. And our emergency response took 3.5 months. And that's just reflective of the size of the event. That because we were moving as fast as we could.
And we don't own those big, heavy equipment, right? So
no.
You guys ordered this ahead of time, brought it in ahead of time,
mm-hmm.
for the...
Staged. Those were staged.
For the... Yeah. Because of the danger.
Yeah. Okay, Gerald. This is Montecito Creek at Hot Springs. To the left there used to be homes. To the right there used to be homes. And this is right after we did some minimal clearing. Just again to get that creek to go under the bridge, okay? And this is a little bit later with the Army Corps of Engineers coming in and recreating that channel. Montecito Creek was one of those creeks where it literally filled beyond capacity, and in some areas upstream from here, downstream from Ashley Road, there was literally no channel. We had to literally recreate a creek in there, okay? And this is some visual of people were facing in Montecito, okay? This is all of Mill Road. So this is some of the stuff that we were initially seeing out there where you literally couldn't even get anywhere. So again, those initial emergency response efforts were focused on clearing the debris out of the roads so that we can assist with rescue and recovery. Okay. This is Oak Creek at the freeway and North Jameson, completely full. Okay. This is an aerial. This was something that the media put out. But what's interesting, that's Brandel Road on the right. That's San Ysidro Creek, where you can see the ribbon of water coming through. And you can see, and that's at East Valley Road, and you can see that huge debris plug right there. Glen Oaks subdivision is down to the lower right, okay? This is a home in Glen Oaks subdivision. This is a home that there's an exact same picture from 1969. A similar picture, obviously, different material, but... it was a big event. Okay. This is looking upstream at that same site on San Ysidro at East Valley Road. This was after minimal clearing had occurred so that we could get the creek back into the channel. Those were some of those boulders that you heard that were being blasted apart because they were literally too big to move. Okay. This is a picture of the dragline dredge in Carpinteria Salt Marsh. The lower portion of Franklin Creek. That was when we finished that, the end of April was our last emergency project under our permits, okay? This just wanted to show you the force of what occurred out there. Those are I-beams from a bridge on Montecito Creek. The tree won. That tree won. Yeah. Go ahead. And this is a culvert. There's a person who's over 6 feet tall for a scale. This is Bella Vista Road culvert on Buena Vista, up way, way upper Buena Vista Creek. Huge amounts of material. And not only was that blocked, but it was blocked for quite a distance upstream. You know, it wasn't just a little tiny plug right at the entrance. Okay. And this is interesting. So there's that curb at the bottom of the photo. That's East Valley Road, I believe, on Toro Canyon Creek. And so that creek is literally filled in beyond capacity. And the next picture is what it looked like after they removed all of the material. Huge amounts. Okay. And this is just showing some of the dragline desilting at Carpenter's Salt Marsh and Franklin Creek. It's just a different way of getting the sediment out of the creek. We actually have routine desilting programs in this area, and we employ the same method. Okay. And one of the things that we also had to do is we had some debris basin embankments that were damaged. We had, this is San Ysidro debris basin. Cold Springs debris basin was also, the spillway was also damaged. And Toro, one of the Toro Canyon debris basin embankments was damaged. And so we had to do emergency repairs on those debris basins because, again, we're at the beginning of our rainy season and we have burned watersheds above us. And we can't leave those peeled open like that. Okay, and there it is fixed. And here's a couple critters that we deal with. And it's a newt on the lower, on the left, and a burrowing owl on the right. And I would be absolutely glad to answer any questions.
Maureen, if I could, before maybe just touch on, certain, and by the way, a huge thank you to you for being here, but certainly your staff, being proactive, certainly before the rains, and certainly reacting afterward. And I guess if I had it right, I'm looking here, and about 470,000 cubic yards, I think, on your slides were out there that were were deposited to the best in a space where you had to remove it. And I'm reading about 68,000 was actually placed somewhere. So about 15% of all that sediments that weren't carried naturally. 15% were epizootal emergency disposal, both at certainly Carpinteria and certainly at Goleta. But I guess the question comes up, where did all the other materials go? And I realize in a short period of time, you have to get rid of an awful lot of that. And that's, I think, the big question for us. And certainly as we go forward, how can we see more of that being perhaps not episodically distributed until, but maybe metered out or stored for a period of time. But just wondering where all the materials ended up. Again, I know you didn't have a lot. Corps of Engineers had a lot to do with that, but maybe you could give us some idea where that went to.
So all of the material from our debris basins, 400,000 cubic yards, was trucked out of the area. It was mainly trucked to Buellton. And so,
to where?
To Granite. Granite has a large piece of property up there, and so they took that material and will process it and do what they need to do and what to do with that material.
So it's their material now once they got it.
Okay.
I'm just thinking of not the sand and the sediment and so forth. It's going to rain again, and we have material that's still loose up there. And my question is probably had nothing to do with Beacon, but how about building permits? How about are they going to rebuild again? Those homes that were destroyed, are they going to be allowed to build again in the path of those drains and so forth? It probably had nothing to do with Beacon, but to me, it would be, you know, what's going to happen to
I'm not well versed in that. I know that there are other people in the flood control department that are working with FEMA. And the mapping and the development and planning and development is but for me, I'm not well versed in that, so I can't answer.
I just, you know, when we talk about first responders, sometimes people don't think about Public Works Department as being the first responder,
right.
But I was out there with Tom that week, and there were people from Public Works that were out digging, looking, you know, still in that survivor mode. And it was just, it was an incredible, it was amazing to see the work from Public Works, obviously, you know, all the other agencies, but Public Works was staged. They were ready to go. And, you know, I think in our county, probably, you know, in Ventura too, flood control is one of those agencies that doesn't get a lot of attention, but they are doing the work early on to keep the basins clear. And I think, you know, this was such an unusual event that with the boulders, but they were out there doing the work and doing the really hard emotional work too. So, but anyway, the county is working on getting, working on planning and permitting to help the folks that are trying to rebuild all at DOS get into that.
Okay, Mr. Williams, then.
Yeah, I want to hear here on Public Works staff. I mean, the preparation on this event was really, I think, saved some lives. I don't think it would, it's clear that it would have been even worse if those basins hadn't been cleared out. Everything would have taken a lot longer if they had not taken the risk to stage and order additional equipment. And for that matter, both Montecito Fire and County Fire ordered mutual aid teams. And that's, of course, a big financial risk, because if nothing happens, you still need to pay for them without any emergency funds. So I think kudos to all those departments and agencies. And even in the city, you know, I mean, it's not only streets, it's flood control, but even the water department has had to be first responders when in fire events, too many people turn on their sprinklers. Mm-hmm. You need to send in your water people in the fire to turn them off to have enough water to fight the fire. So, I mean, people in both city and county public works have had to put themselves on the line big time. On planning, the board has taken two actions to facilitate rebuilding. One has been the approval of the FEMA, what's called a recovery map. It's kind of like an interim firm map, which I know you're familiar with all your struggles and travails in Oxnard flood mapping issues. But it doesn't affect insurance. That's the only thing. It shows advisory elevations, advisory to the agency, not to the public. The agency adopts the advisory levels. We did adopt the advisory levels so that there would be a blanket rule of where people could rebuild and where they couldn't. In addition to that, we've approved a rebuild process that's similar to our previous ones during fires, where you could rebuild the same size building without a discretionary process. In this case, we are allowing people to move them, which is more complicated, but necessary, because we don't want them to rebuild in a spot that's unsafe. And so it is not a discretionary process. There is not any appeals. There's not any design review. We're doing that because of the necessity of speed. So many of insurance policies, unfortunately, cut off after 2 years.
And you know what?
One of the big, the hardest hit areas were not rich homes. The hardest hit areas were half acre lots, which is the remnant of what's left of our middle class in Montecito. Mm-hmm. And so if people can't rebuild within close to the 2 year time frame, they're sunk, they're done.
My doctor, you know, lives in Montecito. He practices in Ventura, and he was telling me that insurance tripled, you know, because he lost half of his home, and then to rebuild it, and then the insurance just absolutely tripled in him, you know.
You're talking about homeowners insurance,
which is
private. Flood insurance, fortunately, is regulated by the government, and they can't triple it. But
But his home insurance just absolutely tripled it. That's why I want to ask that question.
Member Ramirez.
I want to congratulate you and thank you for the work you did. And I'm in Oxnard. Didn't directly impact my city, except we did send up a lot of first responders. I wanted to know if you could say what, if someone could say what the cost was to the county, to the flood control, to, for all of that work that was done. I know there'll be some FEMA reimbursement or emergency, but just a overall amount that it cost to this amazing work?
I don't really, you know, I've heard numbers here and there, and I don't really know how they were generated. You know, the, I know that the debris basin cleanouts were, I want to say, I don't know, 100 million, I think I heard. Yeah, that, and don't heard quote the, me
the
on that, but.
The debris basin cleanouts alone were maybe 100 million. Okay. If you throw in the streets, it's another over 10 million.
Yeah.
If you throw in sheriff and fire, you start edging towards 130 million.
It would be good for, at some point down the road, to have a full accounting so the public
sure.
knows
yeah.
what the cost is and how, if you can prepare for some of these terrible events, you do save some money. Because a lot of times the public is thinking, we don't want to spend that now. We're looking at it in Oxnard in terms of earthquake preparation as well.
Well, and for the flood control district, one of the things that Tom Fanram, our director, has been the director for many years, and he has done an amazing job with putting monies into reserve over the years. And so there is our ability, because we have those reserves, to respond so quickly and to get going on these emergency response projects. But the sheer volume of material and the sheer volume of the response was beyond, you know, our reserves, and that's where we depend on the reimbursement. Yeah, for sure.
Maureen, when you were proactive and ahead of this event, do you, when you're cleaning out your debris basins, do you have permitted places to take it, or is it again the contractors come and bid and they take it away and we save the taxpayers a little bit of money because they don't charge us, or they do charge us?
No, they charge us.
Okay. and they're getting the material. So
right, yeah. Right. So we cleaned out all of the basins prior to the storm. When we have a fire in their watershed, that's what we do.
Mm-hmm.
And we leave it up to the contractors to dispose of the material. And so they give us their bids and do the work based on them managing that material. Right.
Okay, before we move on, Mr. Richards,
I just want to echo the congratulations on the heroic efforts that were undertaken to deal with all this. I think it's amazing to think that, in a way, like looking at the photos, that this was only just 7 months ago, and it's amazing how we've recovered. I mean, I know that we're still recovering, but even so, one question I had with regard to the disposal of the emergency disposal at Goleta Beach in particular and at Carpinteria, are there lessons learned at this point? You know, if you know, for the next disaster, will we continue to you know, dispose in the same way, or are there other locations that have been identified, or is there anything that you can share about that?
I'm not really in a place to talk about lessons. Depending on what the next emergency brings, you know, will the conversations will be had, and we'll decide what we're going to do. It just depends on what we're presented with. I show up and somebody tells me to get emergency permits.
And I can personally
answer. I will
say
that we are doing an after action plan, as we do for all emergencies, and so that information will be shared. And you know, aside from just this information, I mean, you think of all of the communities that were impacted, and I just want to say one thing about the communication amongst our schools and our school districts, because of the kids. This was during school, and so many different school districts stepped in, City College, Goleta School District, Hope School District, to take the kids from Montecito and Cold Spring School. I mean, it was incredible. And then also bringing in nurses, you guys probably heard about this, from Ventura to Santa Barbara, and teachers. So they had contracted buses and worked in conjunction with the CHP to have these folks who were, the critical employees to get them, you know, into Santa Barbara and back again. And I mean, there were so many things that, I mean, we did learn a lot. And people were smart. They acted on the fly and they worked together. So it's almost like, you know, what will the next emergency bring and how will people react? But I do think that there were a lot of really good lessons learned, and maybe, you know, there's ways to improve certain things as well. Doss was going to say something.
Yeah, I would say, I mean, there's some simple lessons learned, but there, you know, it's a tough call. I mean, the simple lesson learned is that you don't want it there. We know that, but the hard part is that the whole reason why there's beaches is because this happens. If this stuff doesn't happen, we wouldn't have beaches, right? And the whole reason we have this organization is because the existence of the dam blocking the San Ynez has stopped a lot of this nourishment from happening. And so from the perspective of beaches, unquestionably the best thing to do is to get sediment that comes from the mountains and washes into the cities back onto the beaches where it's supposed to go. Now, the problem is that conflicts with people's desire to have good water quality all the time, because, you know, sediment coming out onto the ocean creates water quality problems, especially in years when we had the bad luck of having almost no waves, right?
Mm-hmm.
Normally,
sorts of
things would have cleaned up a lot faster, but this happens to be the year that surfers have say is the worst amount of surf in their lifetime, meaning the least waves in their lifetime. And so that has definitely conspired against water quality at Goleta Beach. So it's a tough call. I mean, the alternatives that we have right now is to spend a lot of money disposing it hundreds of miles away, and the air quality impacts of that and the destruction of our streets and roads that creates is also another thing. And I just think there's no way to call that the best environmental option. So the county is looking at other ways and other options, including if there's a ag site, or in my view, if we are going to be doing beach stuff, we should be looking at multiple more sites so that it's a shared burden across the community.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was just going to say that I think it was the concentration. So the lesson learned was the concentration that going to one site. And so I think looking at other opportunities is definitely in the cards.
Okay, Member Weir.
Between counties, I'm assuming there is some collaboration about plans for disposal of debris. Since we share, I mean, a lot of the debris was trucked, you know, to Ventura County Fairgrounds, and we do share, you know, a lot of this. So going forward, it seems like it would be more responsible to be able to, like you said, not truck it so far and be able to truck it to locations where it could possibly, the sediment and the boulders, be stockpiled for future use, because government is constantly buying this stuff from Granite Construction, right?
That's right. That's right.
To fix our river, you know, beds and to nourish our beaches. So basically somebody's getting it, trucking it far away, and then selling it back to us.
Yeah, that's crazy.
It is crazy.
Yeah.
So
it's crazy. And so we have started to stockpile some stuff at Barone Ranch, which is owned by the county next to the Tahigas dump. We temporarily stockpiled some stuff in Janet's district at Foothill, but that stuff's being removed, and it was a relatively small amount of stuff. The problem was we didn't have a good sorting facilities close. Yeah. All we had was Greenwell in Summerlin, and that's teeny, right? And we had fairgrounds in Ventura. But that's trucking it all the way to Ventura and then trucking it all the way back to Goleta Beach after you figure out that it's, after you sort and get all the plastics and parts of people's houses out of the mud. Mm-hmm. So there has got to be a better system. And that's one of the reasons why the county is looking at other spots, either for sorting or for disposal.
Or for stockpiling, I would assume. I mean, I'm hoping Ventura County and Santa Barbara County actually collaborate on this because we have the same needs for boulders and sediment going forward. So it seems like a good plan to do that. And our fairgrounds is having to repave the entire parking lot because it was totally broken up by all the trucking. So there's got to be spots to do that.
I know Mr. Fayram with Santa Barbara County had my conversations with him, or do you have any sites? Do you know any sites? And certainly, I think that's what we had a discussion, I say, amongst Jim Baylard, Mark, and Gerald about if we were able to find some sites somewhere in the Beacon. And, you know, certainly you'll hear that the Ventura County Watershed Protection is going to be buying, I think, or has, or is buying property on Lower Cayugas Creek, which is at the very, very, very end of the pipeline, and, you know, and stockpiling it there. But at least it's stockpile, but then they're maybe having to truck all the way back to the top. So the idea of maybe looking at sites or some places, public spaces, or with the railroads or something, looking at some space where we could be up the pipeline, so to speak, in the Beacon so that would be the spot, so that then we could possibly add it, meter it out, not in huge amounts, but meter it out over time so that it could work its way in. And just like Mr. Hoover was talking about, that sediment's working its way down the coast. So that's sort of what we've put on as one of our things to look at and see where. Again, we don't have the finances, but certainly we could do some of, through Gerald's knowledge and Jim's knowledge, and Mark, be able to at least maybe find some sites to do that.
Well, you know, this was not exactly an occasion that was envisioned by SICBEP, but the SICBEP process would seem to apply here. Maybe it should be expanded to this kind of activity.
Well, we did submit a grant through the Hazard Mitigation Grant Program for the development costs of implementing a new SICBEP program. Unfortunately, it was denied, but we have another grant opportunity that's coming up in the next month, which we will try again. We need about $350,000 for environmental permitting, for up to three locations.
Yeah, this is bigger than anything we thought about when we thought of SICBEP, but
and it is, and
hey, that, and, it is.
And maybe we're eliminating some of the smaller sites and looking at one of the key sites that actually could, again, not be, it would over time benefit all the Beacon, but also a space where we could get it permitted and be able to accomplish something like that. Maybe one or two spaces, one in Santa Barbara, maybe one in the top end of Ventura County, or maybe somewhere, maybe just one. If that came down to that, if we had putting all the resources in one place to have a sorting facility or have somebody come in and contract as a sorting facility, having the wherewithal to do that. I know we don't have the money to buy it, but certainly that, you know, with what we've learned as Supervisor Wolf, the lessons learned, that would possibly one of the things to do. It was very disheartening to know, to watch the wagon train going down and then going east and filling in boulders and stuff and taken to a quarry both in Santa Paula and I think out in that area that actually had been they had been fined for mining into the water table, but we just gave them a gift of huge amounts of materials. Again, I understand we had to go someplace with it, but if we want to be able to have some place in the future to be able to do this. And I would encourage you to ask when you're interacting with both your public works and some of those folks, just these kind of questions need to be brought into so they start at least thinking into the future about how to do that. Because I think, as we know, there's going to be more of these type of events. I'm sorry to go on. We've got a couple other speakers.
Mr. Bennett, I just wanted to point out this conversation is a good conversation and something that Beacon should probably help take a lead on to keep all these organizations talking, because it's real easy to only think narrowly. But I want to be respectful of the fact that we have speakers from Carpinteria and Ventura County that are here also, and they probably would like to get their input before we have our full discussion and stuff.
Sounds good. Just try to go there. Mr. Brennan? Thank you, ma'am.
And Mr. Chair and members of the board, before we transition to public comment, I just want to mention, since we're talking about coordination, there were a number of other federal and state agencies that were involved for coordinating through the Emergency Operations Center. Ms. Spencer mentioned a few that for permitting agencies for Army Corps and Coastal Commission, Regional Water Quality Control Board, but there was also coordination with U.S. Environmental Protection Agency, Cal EPA, of course, Office of Emergency Services for the state, the Coast Guard, U.S. Fish and Wildlife. So I just wanted to make sure there were a number of federal and state agencies involved throughout this process and a lot of coordination.
I'd also like to add for the record that the Ventura County 31st Agricultural District at the fairgrounds, having that facility was a godsend in that situation. Certainly it's put them through some setbacks, but certainly I want to recognize that what they did too. Thank you.